you need to decide if you want to take the red pill or the white pill. If you take the red pill, you're going to see nothing but the truth, a truth that you might not be able to handle. But the red pill will reveal all the things that are not working well, all the negative things to do with these two cars. You might not like it, but you're going to hear about that. If you take the white pill, you're going to see only the good thing, all the positive and the wonderful things about these two vehicles. Whether it's the truth or not, it doesn't matter, because it's going to tell you all the amazing things about these two cars. You have to decide which pill is right for you, and then I will take the story from there. So you have taken the red pills, which means you are ready for the truth and nothing but the truth. So I'm going to tell you all the things that are not working very well in both the Mazda MX-30, which is all new for 2022, and the Toyota RAV4 Prime, which was also new for 2021. These two cars compete somewhat directly, and also you might argue indirectly, but they both have some limitation that you need to know. First, on the Mazda MX-30, well, the most complaints that you hear all the time is range, range, and range. And you've heard this time and time again. Now, there may be a good reason why Mazda have only put 100 miles or 161 kilometer of range in the MX-30, but regardless of the reason behind it, it is still a problem. I've had this car for a week now, and I keep charging every couple of days because of range anxiety in a case that I run out of the juice. So that is the biggest issue with this one. Now, on the actual Prime, on the Toyota side, range is even worse, almost half. It's 42 miles or 68 kilometers in pure electric format. But the difference between these two is that this is a plug-in hybrid, which means you can continue to drive when the electricity or the battery pack is empty or near empty. In addition to the challenge with range, another thing that you need to keep in mind is that the Mazda MX-30 is not a true four-door crossover. By that, I mean it has what we call suicide door or clamshell doors in much the same way the Mazda RX-8 had many, many years ago. Perhaps they're trying to be a bit of a spiritual successor to the RX-8, but it doesn't work too well in this type of a crossover because we buy this for practicality and functional reasons. So what does it mean to have the clamshell doors? Well, it works for the most part if you're a person who don't really need to carry a lot of passengers, but if you need to let the kids in and out of the back door, it's just a bit of a clumsy situation because you always have to open the front doors first before you open the rear doors. That's the second limitation and a challenge with the Mazda MX-30. The third thing that I'm not too crazy about is the interior, which I'm going to show you in a second here. It's a beautiful design, amazing, amazing interior aesthetics, but there's some stuff that is not super functional. A few more things to keep in mind about the Mazda MX-30 is that it only comes in front-wheel drive format. Once again, that will be remedied when the plug-in hybrid comes out, but for now, it is not an all-wheel drive like the way it is on the plug-in hybrid RAV4 Prime. Finally, because of the small battery pack and very limited range, I suspect that the resale value of the MX-30 will not be very good in, let's say, 4 or 5 years down the road when there will be so many electric cars with much better range. So if you're leasing this, perhaps for business or for a short commuter drive, it's probably totally fine. Return it in 3 or 4 years and you're totally okay with that. But I would not buy this one, keep it for 5 or 6 years and hope that you'll get good resale value because I don't think that is going to happen. Last thing I want to point out in terms of the challenges with MX-30 is to do with interior. So let me show you the interior and tell you what I'm not too crazy about. Okay, so now I'm inside the Mazda MX-30, and let me point out a few things I'm not too crazy about. My primary concern is the infotainment system, which is too small and too low to make it truly, truly practical when you're driving. Instead of having a larger tablet style in front of you, like the way we find in RAV4 and in most other cars and SUVs, this one is split into two. So you get some of the controls and displays in the front to make it easier for you to see when you're driving. driving, but most of the things that you have to touch and move around and manage is below the dash, and it is quite low and not all that big. So I'm just finding that as I'm trying to change the temperature, play with defrosters, all that stuff, I just find it very awkward. It's also not super user friendly, and so I think they have some work to do in terms of the software and the hardware integration of the infotainment system. The other thing is that while this floating design is beautiful to look at, we have this kind of Volvo style two-tier design, which again looks good and perhaps saves some space, but if you put something down here, it's hard to tell what's in there because you can't see it, and to get it you have to really reach out from this side or this side. In both directions, it is awkward to do. I found the cup holders to be a little bit too far back and too recessed below. So while there's nothing wrong with the size of the cup holders, I just find once again, ergonomically, it's a bit awkward. So those are some of the complaints I have with the Mazda's interior. And of course, I pointed out already how difficult it is to get in and out of the back seat, even though the clamshell doors open this way and you think you'll be okay, it is still pretty tight back there. So those are things that you need to know because you took the red pills. Now let me go into the RAV4 and continue my story. So I've now transitioned to the RAV4 Prime's interior. This 2021 version is the one that we do own, so I know a lot about this RAV4 Prime, but because you are still taking the red pill, I'm going to tell you the truth about what's not working with the RAV4 Prime. And the primary thing is that if you want to use this as a fully electric vehicle, then you only have 42 miles or 68 kilometers of range, and which means you gotta plug in almost every day or every second day. Now, fortunately, we don't drive a lot with this RAV4 Prime, so that kind of works for us. But for those of you who have a longer commute or you want to take it for a longer drive, you're going to have to default back to the hybrid mode when the battery is running out. And so those are some of the things you need to keep in mind if you want to use this as a fully electric vehicle. If not, then that isn't so much of a concern. The other thing is that compared to the Mazda MX-30, it's simply not as fun to drive. Surprisingly, these two cars are quite similar in terms of drivability, handling, ride, and quietness, but the MX-30 does everything a little bit better than the RAV4 Prime. This one is a bit softer, not as fun to drive, not as agile, and for the most part, it is a bit boring to drive overall. And so those are some of the things I pointed out on the RAV4 Prime. Finally, it's almost impossible to get one. There's almost a 2-year waiting list. We waited about a year to get the RAV4 Prime, and so that's the issue. Even if you want to buy this, you can't even get one until Toyota ramps up the production of the RAV4 Prime. So those are things that I'm not too crazy about the RAV4 Prime. Now let me talk about things that are positive for both of these vehicles. But for that, you have to take the white pill first. So I am still in the RAV4 Prime, and because you've now taken the white pills, I can talk about all the amazing positive things about the RAV4 Prime and also the Mazda MX-30, but let me do it here first in the Toyota RAV4 Prime. The positive thing is almost the reverse or the mirror image of the negative things, which is because there is a limited number of production models available for the RAV4 Prime, it means the resale value is tremendously good. In fact, I've had this RAV4 Prime for almost a year now, and I can sell this right now for about $5,000 to $6,000 more than what I paid for, which is shockingly good. And most likely I can keep it for another year or two and not lose any money. So those are some really amazing resale value, partly because it's a very limited production, but also because it's Toyota, which means it has first level quality. And this particular RAV4 Prime is actually built in Japan, not built in Ontario like the normal hybrids. And while there is a very little difference between the two, there is still subtle difference in terms of paint quality and interior fit and finish. So quality is excellent, resale value is really, really good. And if you like the feel of a larger, more luxurious SUV, then the RAV4 Prime definitely has a bit more of that compared to Mazda MX-30. It's very quiet on the highway. It feels very, very soft and cushy and comfortable and refined on a variety of different road conditions. It's bigger and roomier. You get regular full-size four doors, unlike the Mazda MX-30. And generally speaking, because of the traditional design inside, it's a very comfortable place to spend time. And then, of course, finally, the infotainment system, while it's a bit outdated, is definitely easier to use and much more practical than the Mazda's version, because the infotainment system is big, it's all touch panel, and you get combination of both buttons and touch control. And I find the software and the interface more intuitive to use than the Mazda's version. So those are some of the positive things on the RAV4 Prime. I also like the fact that it's super fast from 0 to 60. It's one of the fastest cars in Toyota's lineup, only second to Supra, thanks to the combination of the hybrid with a 2.5-liter engine combined with the electric motor that will give you a tremendous acceleration under all kind of conditions, which you won't get in the Mazda MX-30. That thing is a much more leisurely feel when it comes to the acceleration part. So those are some really interesting stuff to do with the RAV4 Prime. Now let me take you back into Mazda MX-30 and talk about things I do like about the Mazda model. Okay, so I'm back in the Mazda MX-30, and you are still taking the white pill, so I can talk about the positive things about the MX-30 now. Now, before I go too far, keep in mind that the RAV4 Prime and the MX-30 isn't exactly an apple-to-apple comparison, simply because this is a fully electric car, and that one is a plug-in hybrid. The advantage of the RAV4 Prime, of course, is that when you run out of the juice or battery, you can continue to drive in the hybrid format, which you can't do in the Mazda. However, the battery pack is larger in the MX-30, and so you get 100 miles or 161 kilometers of range, which I mentioned earlier, compared to only 42 miles or 68 kilometers of range in the RAV4 in the electric mode. So that's a big advantage, and even though the range is small, much smaller than what we would like to see in electric mode, it also means that it takes much less time to charge the battery. So if you want to quickly top up the battery and continue to do some short driving range, then you can do that in a very convenient way with the Mazda MX-30, whereas larger cars with a larger battery pack will require much longer time to charge up. So that's one advantage. Second, a big advantage of the Mazda MX-30 compared to not just the RAV4 Prime, but other electric cars is that it drives way better. It's more agile, the steering is accurate and precise. I wouldn't call it super sporty, but it is definitely more fun to drive following the tradition of a Mazda to offer more sportier feel. So I noticed that it tracks straight, the ride is smooth but very planted, and around the corners it stays flat. And you don't usually get that in something like a Tesla, they don't drive quite as good. And this thing is just solid in terms of driving both in city road and also highway, and it just feels really, really well manufactured. It is built in Japan, and Mazda have a really good reputation for not just the driving dynamics but also good quality overall, interior and exterior, and that really shows up in this MX-30. Finally, the Mazda MX-30 has a beautiful design interior-wise and exterior. Even though I complain about the functionality of the interior, well, in terms of the actual design, it's hard to beat. It's kind of boring to see lots of electric cars these days out there because none of them looks all that great, but this one seems to combine good design of a crossover with some of the newer trend that we see in electric vehicles to come up with something that I think won't look out of place 5 or 6 years down the road. So my hat's off to Mazda for amazing design that still keeps some of the traditional looks. And of course, in the interior, they even use cork all over the interior because Mazda started its business with the cork production. So it kind of harks back to some of that spiritual connection that Mazda had with the cork manufacturing. So those are some cool things that you see. And the combination of the cloth and some of the fabric and the color, really, really well done, and you can tell that they spent a lot of time designing the right kind of elements into this MX-30, and that's a really good positive thing about the MX-30. So whether you took the red pill or white pill, let me finish off with some truth about comparing the Mazda MX-30 to RAV4 Prime. If you want something that handles a little bit better, more agile, more fun to drive, with a cool design, exterior and interior, Mazda is the one to pick. If you want something with a more traditional design, traditional look and feel, and you don't want to worry about range anxiety, obviously RAV4 Prime is the right one for you. But in either case, something to keep in mind is that because Mazda probably will bring the plug-in hybrid version of the MX-30 next year, perhaps in 2022 or 2023, I would wait for that. But that would be a perfect combination of a good handling, a good agile car with a long range. And if you're interested in the RAV4 Prime, I might kind of wait a little bit longer because summer of 2022, they will introduce fully electric vehicle. The Beyond Zero models like the bZ4X is a lot like a RAV4 Prime, but with much longer range. And you can drive that in fully electric mode all the time because it is a fully electric car. So those are some of my recommendations. I hope you enjoy the comparison of the two very interesting SUVs right now. Please stay tuned with more videos, and I look forward to catching up with you on the next video. Signing off for now. Thank you so much.